Sorry about that. We were having some prompter issues, and I'm the issue. So it's time to check in with Dr. Scott Robertson right now. He has a look at acne.
That's right. It's been several years since we talked about acne on the show, and certainly it's one of the more common things that I will see in my office, and it's one of the more common skin conditions that you can see across the entire population. It's estimated right now about 50 million Americans suffer from some type of acne, so that's nearly 1 in 6, and about 85% of teenagers will get acne as they go through their teenage years. I can remember, you know, 3 or 4 years of being a teenager where it just didn't seem like it would ever go away.
Mm-hmm. Right. It's just one of those things you just expect to deal with during your teen years.
And one of the interesting...
I have no idea what you guys are talking about. I never experienced it.
Then you are blessed, Sarah. You
know, I'm totally kidding.
You know, one of the things that always seems interesting to me is a lot of folks don't have a lot of good perceptions about acne, and there's a lot of myths and misconceptions about it.
For sure.
And teenagers and adolescents are not alone in their search for acne treatment. Many adults in their 30s or 40s can develop acne, and I see several of these frustrated patients each week with concerns about their skin. Many patients endure years of the unsightly lesions without seeking a proper medical evaluation, and this is unfortunate because there are many safe and effective treatments for acne. If you had acne as a teenager, then you are likely exposed to many of the myths surrounding its cause. So let's take a look at some of these common misconceptions. First, acne is generally not caused by poor hygiene. As a matter of fact, if you wash your face too much, you may dry out your skin and actually make matters worse. Second, acne is not caused by specific foods. Now, that doesn't mean you can go out and eat all the potato chips and chocolate you want. There is evidence from a single 2008 study in Australia that foods with a higher glycemic index, such as sweets, may increase the number of pimples in those who already suffer from acne. Next, acne is not just a cosmetic disease. Although not a serious threat to your physical health, acne can leave permanent physical and emotional scars on those who are not treated. And lastly, you just don't have to let acne run its course. Treatment is available and can significantly reduce the amount of lesions seen on the skin. The treatment of acne is really a process with two major goals: to lower the concentration of bacteria on the skin's surface and to reduce the amount of cellular debris and excessive oil secretion present on the affected areas. Topical treatments with medicated lotions or creams is the first line of defense, and these treatments may contain benzoyl peroxide, antibiotics, or Retin-A. For some patients, oral antibiotics, birth control pills, and the controversial medication Accutane may be appropriate for the treatment and control of their acne. For most patients, it's best to start with over-the-counter benzoyl peroxide products combined with a mild soap. If using these products isn't helpful, it's likely best to see a healthcare provider with experience in acne treatment. After an examination of the skin, they can then determine which is the best custom course of action for you. And so, Sarah and Randall, when patients come in, a lot of them haven't actually gone through some of the steps. And maybe they've tried one thing for a week or two and already kind of passed judgment. But you really need to use some of these treatments for a period of 4 to 6 weeks before you can decide whether it's working best for you. Mm-hmm. For instance, over-the-counter benzoyl peroxide products can really be helpful for a vast majority of patients if they combine them with a mild soap and not overly wash their skin too much. It's also important to have realistic expectations when treating acne. You're not going to go from having, you know, 15 to 20 lesions on your skin to having no lesions on your skin, but if you can cut down that amount by 50 or 70%, a lot of people are very happy with their treatment at that point. If using some of these over-the-counter products, you're not getting the results you want, it is important that you go in to see someone with some experience because they may have other options for you. And when you look at the dermatology research, all the dermatologists keep pointing back to topical Retin-A, which is really effective at not only removing some of that cellular debris on the top of the epidermis of the skin, but also cutting down that oil secretion. A lot of people don't tolerate Retin-A, and it may be that they're using the wrong concentration, or they may be using it too frequently. So if you're having tolerability issues, it's important that you report those back to your healthcare provider so they can tailor your regimen.
Okay, and that means, because it makes your skin very sensitive to sunlight and to just make it very irritated. Is that
absolutely
what you're talking about?
Right.
Okay.
Dr. Scott, thank you.